Good morning, everyone. We're here on behalf of Amutat BeTamar and the ASF Institute of Jewish Experience to talk about reclaiming identities.
My name is Shani Oshri. I live in Tel Aviv, originally from Netanya. Professionally, I'm an opera singer and folk music singer. I'm the first of nine brothers, and that's it. And I'm happy to be here.
Hello, my name is Lior. I'm 40 years old, married with two kids. I'm originally from Netanya also, and I live in Lod for the past 10 years, and I'm a social activist.
Hi, my name is Ovadya, Sagi Giar, and I was born in a small settlement 45 minutes south of Tel Aviv. And my profession is a silversmith, and that's it.
I'm Dalya Arussy. I grew up in the U.S. and I live now in Jerusalem with my husband, and I work with the ASF Institute of Jewish Experience. I'm very much looking forward to this conversation today.
My name is Naama Perl, Tsadok. I live in Kibbutz Tiratzvi. I'm married to Uriel and I have four kids. In my profession, I'm a musician. I'm a music composer. I write music to ensembles, to orchestras and diverse media. On my other hat, I'm a lecturer and a music teacher, and I'm very thrilled to be here today.
And now to start the conversation, we're all second or third generation in Israel, and we'll go around asking where are you born, where is your family from? Shani?
Hi, I'm born in Israel. I'm third generation here. I'm half Persian, half Yemeni. My mother is Persian, my father is Yemeni, and I really like all the culture and all the food, of course, and the language and the music.
I was born in Kiryat Ono. I'm a third generation from the Aliyah, and my grandparents are from Tunisia and from Yemen. My mother's side is from Tunisia and my father's side is from Yemen.
Both of my parents was born in Morocco. My mother is from Casablanca and my father is from Aswera. And my father did Aliyah in 1956. He went to Beit She'an. And my mother did Aliyah in 1967. And she went to Netanya. That's where my parents met and had me.
How old were your parents when they came to Israel?
My father was 15 and my mother was 10.
So I was born and raised in a small settlement 45 minutes south of Tel Aviv called Bnei Re'em. And I was actually born here in Rehovot, in the hospital. My grandfather and grandmother came from Yemen, from the side of my mother. They came from Raime. And from the side of my father, they came from Daje, which is 3 hours east to Sana'a.
I'm half Yemenite, half Ashkenazi. My father's side his parents came from Yemen. His father came from Sana'a and his mother came from a village called Menache in 1949 with the Big Aliyah.
What kind of stories did you hear from your parents?
Tradition and culture and food and family stories and it was always talked about in a very nostalgic way, in a very positive way. I think life in Morocco was very difficult because it was a poor country and the Jews sometimes had persecuted against them, but still the notion was that everything was, the water tastes better there, and the fruit was excellent, and everything was wonderful. And it was because that mostly my father was, and also my mother, they had such a huge difference between the way that they felt in Morocco, that they were, and they welcomed, and they felt apart and belonging, and the way that they felt a part of coming home to the Jewish state and didn't feel welcome and didn't feel like anybody is actually treating them with the right respect or the right tribute to their cultural knowledge. So I think in general that's the story and that's the atmosphere that we had at home. And Morocco was always present. I mean, we heard music from Morocco. My parents and I spoke Moroccan to each other, and it was very, very apparent, and it was like a like a bubble in time. I mean, we lived in Israel, I grew up in Israel, but home was like an island still belonging to Morocco.
So I have a lot of story about Tehran from my grandma, from Safta Sarah. She told me about the green village and such a beautiful nature. And of course, great food. From my Yemeni side, actually, I didn't heard a lot of story. I know that when they came to Israel, I know they came to the Ma'abara, and I know that two of my grandma's sister has died in the way, in the plan, I don't know, and they don't talk about it, and I believe because there's a sad story there, and I hope one day I will heard it.
Yes, well, I heard a lot of stories. Almost every Saturday that we spent on our grandparents' house in a Moshav Tarom, my grandmother took us and took all the grandsons and around her and with a big pile of cut vegetables and told us a lot of stories about Yemen, about her small village called Medid, and about the life there, about how they played the kids and how she went to bring water to the house.
You could understand from their behavior, the way that they express themselves when they speak about Yemen and the time in Israel. You can see how they change immediately their face, and how they, you see the smile, or see the eyes just, you know, dreaming, and you can see that it reflects something that we can say good, but immediately when they move the stories from here, if they told you stories from Israel and from the Aliyah, they change their shape completely.
Shani, you only mentioned stories from your Iranian side. Did you feel then maybe more connected to the Iranian side of your heritage because of that, or did you feel equally connected to your Yemenite side?
I really took from my grandma a lot of things, a lot of songs, a lot of food and culture from the Iranian side, but the Yemeni side, I grew up with, I have two home because I'm a daughter of a divorced parent. So my father's house was very Yemenite, every Shabbat, Kubana and Jachnun, and we have a lot of Yemenite music, Yemenite Jewish music, but only the men music, not the woman music, not the Arabic songs, only the Hebrew songs. So I really connected to my Yemenite culture and my Yemenite side, but not from the old country, from Yemenite. So I have a beautiful story that I hope that I try to succeed to say it in English. When I was, I think, 10 years old, I tried to do audition from the choir. I go to the music teacher and I sing to her, and of course I learned to sing from my father, from Kiddush dinner, from the Shabbat dinner, the songs of the Jewish Yemenite people. And I didn't pass the audition because she told me that I'm too meselselet and we don't know how to translate to English, so I just like, it's too much melismatic, exactly. So I didn't pass the audition, and every, you know, holiday or stuff that the choir do stuff in the school, I just heard it from the side and look at it. And few years later, I was singing with the Natania Kibbutz Orchestra in the Hala Tarbut, and I saw her with all the students from my school, and I was singing opera, and I think this is why I chose to learn opera and not go to the Yemenite songs. And I'm very happy that in the corona time I took lessons with the Yemenite teacher, and this is my closure with the Yemenite music.
I remember one story that can maybe put these things out. I remember when I was in sixth grade in the school, we had some tutors from sixth grade to the first graders, and they had to choose students from the class to go to be tutors to the kids from first grade, and they pick up only the Ashkenazi rich kids in the class. And I remember that I got so angry. I don't know where it came from, but I got so angry because I knew that I'm a smart kid. Sorry. I was a smart kid, but I live in the wrong neighborhood and I'm Mizrahi, I'm Yemenite. It's not fair. It's really not fair. And I feel this angry right now. And I remember that I went to the principal office without any shame and I told him, it's not fair. Why are you thanking them and not me? I can do it. I can do it exactly like them. And I think he was very surprised with my behavior because I was so quiet and a nice kid. And I was so angry that finally they took me to be a tutor. But it was, you know, it's like one story to see the, it's so obvious that we take the Ashkenazi and rich kids to be tutors because, you know, they should do it. We got only Ashkenazi sidurs in the school. We learned only Ashkenazi prayers, only Ashkenazi piyutim and songs of Shabbat when we did Shabbats in school. So it wasn't a mistake. It was, I guess, also on purpose. These are my stories. And only in the last few years, I just reclaiming my identity, going back, going to see, because I feel that something was broken between the first generation of the Aliyah to our generation. In the middle, this middle that they had to be here and to fit in and to be like part of the society, and we are now, and we are feeling that it's strange, and we need to bring this voice up again. So we are doing the reclaiming of this identity. This is what I feel that we need to cover up for our second generation.
I have two initiatives that I want to talk about that are very related to the conversation that we had. I understood that the way that our parents or grandfathers and grandmothers was treated was wrong, was immoral and wrong. And I saw it in first hindsight, and I saw it with my own eyes, the way that the Israeli society does it again, does it with the Ethiopian community. The same exact stereotype. We do a ceremony that we present the documentation, we present the story, and we do a big, very emotional event. And it's incredible that you see older people standing in front of the portrait. We do a very big portrait, and they cry because they saw somebody heard the story. Somebody is put the story on paper, and it's there for the next generation of his own family, of his immediate family. I wrote a children's book that is trying to create a bridge between the generation of the grandfathers and grandmothers to the generation of the grandkids, and it's called Why Grandmas Call Me Kapara. And teach them the meanings of each and every word. And basically, I will do maybe a little bit of a spoiler. The meaning is love. She loves you. I mean, that's the meaning.
When I start to research the tradition, it leads me to be passionate to the language of the Jewry. And because the Jewry in the traditional Yemenite Jewish Jewry has a language, and when you learn the secret esoteric symbols, then the whole world reveals in front of you. And then you find yourself in a major conflict. I realize that I need to, or I want to continue this tradition, but I need to know this tradition first. So I bought a lot of books about the research book about the tradition, and to understand, because my family didn't pass the tradition correctly because they suffer from some philosophy that said that we need to erase your tradition to create a new Jewish, a new Israeli people. So So it influenced me a lot, my movement in this world to preserve the tradition. And I think it's really important for me and for the next generation to learn and not to be ashamed, to touch and to learn and to carry on you the tradition.
I have such a rich culture, which I thought I knew something about it, but I don't know anything. I knew the songs from my house, from my grandparents' house. I knew about the food. Everybody knows about the food. I knew about a little bit about the jewelry, but it was only the peak of the culture. And I felt like I need to research more and more and more and to take out more layers of this culture. So I found out that the songs that already got into the Israeli canon of music was actually erased from other side of the Arabic Yemenite. They took only the parts of the Hebrew lyrics. When they took piyutim from the Diwan, so it's only the first of all, it's only the men's musical tradition. But even when they took it, they took only the parts in Hebrew and not in Arabic Yemenite, which is also kind of, you know, erasing the identity of the Arabs, and we only speak Hebrew. This was a bit surprise for me. And also about the women's songs, which is a tradition that it's not here, a tradition that passed away. So my little project was to take some of these songs and to put them in a more large landscape. I made an album with those songs, first to bring this tradition into the center of stage, and second to move it on, to let it be recorded and documented.
My experience is a little bit different because it was in the US and it was all Ashkenazim, at least in the school that I went to. And I guess Shani is the only one who said that she didn't have like a split or a large group with her from her heritage. And so what I want to ask is, did you, aside from these stories, what happened to you, how did you feel dealing with those situations? Did you want to be part of the Ashkenazim?
When I was a kid, when I was a teenager, even a young man, you might say I drank the Kool-Aid. I mean, I was totally in that sense of the Ashkenazi are much better people than the Mizrahi, the much more intelligent. They have a better culture, they have literature and music, and well, maybe the food is not that good, but you know, you can win it all. And so that was my sense. And when I studied in the university, I also studied Jewish studies, and of course all the thinkers and all the rabbanim and all the books was written by European Jews, of course. And your culture doesn't have any books. Your culture doesn't have any knowledge. So it's irrelevant. And my sense was I should be thankful and just understand that I have a lot to learn from them. And if I will play my cards right, I can assimilate myself and be a part of that success, the Israeli success story. And it took me a few events and a few incidents and quite a few years to understand that all that was a big lie, and it wasn't that my culture doesn't have any heritage, doesn't have any thinkers or books or thinkers or what, all those things that I mentioned. And actually all of us, I think, and a lot of my friends are doing an action of rediscovering, of reclaiming, and maybe a little bit like an archaeologist. You have to chip away the different layers to reach the reality, which is the truth. I mean, it's not made up reality, and we don't glorify the past. I mean, we have the culture, rich enough culture that we can lay on, and we can use it as a platform for us to to grow and evolve. It took me quite a few years and quite a little bit of effort of discovering that with myself and do a little bit of research and understanding the way that the Israeli society is construct. A lot of it is based on racism, and a lot of it is based on erasing. The action, the most common action is with my culture is erasing. It's an erased culture, and you have to rediscover it.